Good afternoon, good evening, brothers and sisters. Thank you all for tuning in, listening in. Tune in to Holla at the Success Scholar. I'm the Success Scholar, Haki Ammi here, Sapho, Honorable One. Thank you for tuning in, listening in. Well, you know I wear many hats, of course, and, you know, today, you know, I just couldn't go without doing this show this evening. And, of course, we, in a very critical time, as we see the various levels of challenges that we experience, particularly in this, I'd say the northern half of the hemisphere, with various weather changes, and many people have seen rather recently what's going on. Of course, you know, unless you've been under a rock, you know about the situation in Houston, Texas, with Hurricane Harvey. And so I finally got this sister on the phone with me. She was on the Carl Nelson show. I was going to get her a few months ago, but, you know, the opportunity arose and she was available at this time. And I believe she is on the phone, the line. Sister Anelle?
Yes, I am. Hello, Brother Haki.
All right, brothers and sisters, thank you. We have on the line calling us here from Houston, Texas, Sister Anelle Williams. And I've known her for a few years now. She's been an attendee at the Power Networking Conference. I know starting in Dallas, maybe she went a few times before, but I know she's a psychologist as well as working with the Association of Black Psychologists. And I know that we have gone to the ABSI conference over the past few years, and she recently attended that. So I wanted to bring someone that's actually in Houston to the eLife Media listening audience and really just have this discussion of what actually is going on from someone that is working with the mental health. I've read some articles of what's going on down there, but, you know, I couldn't imagine the experiences that we've seen. But first, let me just welcome you, Sister Anelle. How are you doing? First and foremost,
I'm doing about as well as can be expected, Brother Haki.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I survived the hurricane. I only had water in one room, and we are grateful for just that.
Oh, wow. Okay. So for those that may not, you know, looking at a map, the southeast part of Houston, what are some of the counties or and what's that relationship to where you are? Where is that?
Okay. First of all, a lot of different parts of Houston got hit.
Okay.
Southeast part, the southwest part, the west part. So, you know, I can't really separate it from and say it's only the southeast.
Okay. Okay.
I live on the north side of the city. It just so happened that my neighborhood was spared from the severe flooding, but just a few blocks down the road, you know, people have stuff piled on the curb that they got flooded. So it kind of, you know, some of us were hit and miss. It missed us, but maybe got somebody a few blocks down. Well, and then also on the last last street in the subdivision across the street is flooded, but that last street backed up to a bayou. So it flooded from the back of the houses over there and also from the front, because the water in the front of the subdivision, all that water was traveling back toward the bayou like it would normally do if we didn't have, you know, concrete and houses and all of that. So they flooded from the front and the back. So it was unpredictable. Lots of people got caught in this. Houston is a city of lots of bayous and creeks and tributaries, you know, just all over the city. And when the city gets bombarded with a whole lot of rain like we got, it's just, it's hard to avoid a flood because of the sheer construction or the infrastructure of Houston. Mm. And, you know, and many people may not know that Houston was built on a swamp.
Mm.
And, you know, when they were trying to build the city, they had so many problems with it. People walked around in mud and slush all the time. Houston used to be the capital of Texas, but because folks were so frustrated with all the water and mud down here in Houston, the mosquitoes, they moved state capital to Austin. So that's our history here. We're built on top of a swamp with all of this concrete, and we're only about a little over 30 feet above sea level.
Mm.
So, right, and so we're, you know, only about 50 miles off the coast.
Yeah.
So when there's a storm surge and the water is coming in at 28 and 30 feet, the water that's here that would normally flow out to the Gulf or flow out the tributaries and bayous has nowhere to go.
Mm.
So it gets jammed up in the city while it's raining, and then the water can't go anywhere because of the storm surge. Our tributaries, the bayous, and even though they have widened the bayous, they fill up and they're overflowing. We have reservoirs and all sorts of, you know, holding ponds and all of that to catch water. But when you talk about nearly 50 inches of rain in a short span of time, the city can't manage that. And so whereas we had a situation where Houston is built on a 100-year, an idea that the biggest flood will happen once every 100 years and based on what that kind of rain would be, well, now we have a new reality. We have a new new reality, a new mark. So whatever it was that we thought, you know, could happen in Houston or couldn't happen in Houston, wherever that water line is in our homes or on the street, that's the new reality. That's what we need to be planning for instead of a 100 years flood. We need to be planning for an 800 or 1,000-year flood, a millennia, because they're calling this the storm of the century. Mm. And this is only 2017.
Wow.
So our city, our city is going to have to rethink our infrastructure. Even though we've done what we've done, we still have to look at what is the capacity of the city and how can the capacity of the city be increased. And for one thing that the city is going to have to plan better is where we put concrete.
Yes.
And where we leave land that can drain water, where there's green space, there's soil. Because you can, you know, you're in a swamp, you can't cover everything in concrete. Where the water's going to go? And you got all these bayous. It's not like some cities where the city is contiguous. You know, you don't have to worry about that. Maybe you may have a body of water on the outskirts of town somewhere. These bodies of water, these bayous run all throughout the city, everywhere. They're everywhere.
Ooh.
You can hardly find any place you can live in Houston that a bayou is not nearby.
Wow. Interesting. Yeah, thanks for sharing some of those inputs. And I'm not sure how many houses I saw. The last report was maybe 100,000 houses, or has it that number escalated more? Approximately.
I haven't seen the final numbers on how many houses and apartments and townhomes and all of that. And I'm not sure the final numbers are in. I know the estimates are, you know, they're working on all of that. And insurance claims are made and all of that, and they get an accounting. We'll see what the final number is. Mm-hmm. But, of course, we know that it's a lot, you know.
Yes.
And what that number is, we don't know, but we know it's a lot.
Mm-hmm. And speaking, and I did read a report that said that talked about, you know, I've been, you know, very – you know, active in terms of understanding the balancing act that many areas have with development. And you spoke about how Houston is, well, I saw an article, shall I say, and you kind of added on about the overdevelopment, you know, just the you know, concrete, what is it? How many people is it? I believe it's they couldn't.
I don't know what the number. I know the greater Houston area is 6.5.
Right, that,
I
saw that.
I think the city is about 2. I want to think the city is about 2.5. Houston proper,
yes,
in terms of the boundaries of the actual city.
Right.
But in the metropolitan area, we're looking at about 6.5.
Mm-hmm.
Because the way Houston is, Houston may have certain boundaries, but let's say you could go a mile and you're in another municipality.
Right.
But most people don't even think of it as different because you're still driving straight down the street. And, you know, you get to one point, that's Bel Air. You go to another block or two, that's West University. You drive over here, that's Spring Branch. You go over here. So a lot of the when you talk about the area, it's very difficult to look at Houston in terms of Houston's geographical lines for the city because we are so closely connected. You know, like I said, you walk on one side of the street, it's a different city. A smaller city, but it's like a city within Houston.
Mm. Right.
And
that's
West University is one of those cities. Bel Air is one of those cities that sits inside of the city of Houston.
Now there's one challenge that that was talked about. I saw. Well, Sylvia alluded, said she saw on the news that how many people did not have coverage, like flood insurance.
Yeah.
You know, could you speak to that, to your knowledge? What you know, like
80%? Yeah, it's unfortunate. I've heard the information as well that, I mean, a very, very small people have flood insurance. You would think in a place like Houston.
Yeah.
With
right.
the propensity for flooding, because we've had 3 major floods in about 2 years. Or
oh, really?
Months.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
I did not know that. Okay.
Yes, we had a flood April 2015.
Mm-hmm.
That was really, no, April 2016. Where it was just really, we had a tremendous flooding then. Then we turned around and we had it, was it this past Memorial weekend? I mean, Memorial 2017, I think it was.
Mm.
So you got another year, then you have, you know, we have another. So in a span of about a year and a half or 18 months, we have had 3 major floods here in Houston. Some areas have flooded all 3 times.
Wow.
Some just 2. And, you know, even though I'm talking about these 3, but we've had some before then. We had something came through and we had, I guess that was the April one when Greens Point area, which is on the north side of town, flooded so badly. And that area is prone to flooding as well. So some of the areas that have flooded really badly, you know, they may have to look at maybe those spaces need to be made into green space and
mm-hmm.
maybe there shouldn't be any property in those areas.
Mm.
And the other thing, too, you have to look at the construction of the freeways. The way the freeways are designed, let's say in some of the areas where you have the exchanges, you may have 2, 3, 4 levels of freeway where there's an exchange, which means that that lower level is really low and it dips down and has these little places where water runs down into, because it's kind of like a little valley down in there. It's a little little bowl. So these spaces under freeways are just terrible places to drive through. If anybody's approaching an underpass, because a lot of them, they're not flat ground. People think that the underpass is flat. They're not all flat. They slope or they dip and maybe come back up on the other side of the exchange. And that's why a lot of people end up dying within their vehicles, because they assume that the land is flat and they drive through all of this water. And then they discover, and it has gauges. The city has been very good about putting gauges. It may have a gauge that might say, if you see this line, it's 7 feet. Or this is 9 feet. So if people are not paying attention, and they're driving into these areas that have slopes that are little dips in up under the freeway, and they come up on the other side. And we have a lot of those spaces in Houston, so they may need to rethink the way the freeways are designed and maybe not put these little dips under there, because they're a hazard for a city that floods a lot, you know?
Yeah, it's interesting.
And it provides an opportunity for water to gather and pool in a place, because that place becomes a holding tank. I'm sure everybody sees these places on the freeway where they show the before look, where the freeway is all clear and it looks all wonderful. Then a day or so later, they show it, and they show all of this water. A lot of those is because those spaces become reservoirs for water.
Right, yeah. And just speaking of that, I have, I'm not sure if you know, Arnell, I've actually worked in emergency medical services and fire service.
I knew that.
So I just, you know, I have several books, but one is a community emergency response team. Like I'm not sure if what is called in Maryland, I'm sorry, in Texas, but.
It's called Community Emergency Response Team.
Oh, okay, yeah. So, right. So,
we have it here, and I've gone through training myself.
Oh, great. Yeah. Oh, well, that's a good thing. So, I have my CERT guide out, and one of the things that I turned to the flood page, and you mentioned some of the things. It says, "Do not walk, swim, or drive through floodwaters."
Yes.
And what to say? Learn and practicing driving in local. I'm sorry. Learn and practice driving the local flood evacuation routes.
So you know the streets. So you know which ones are low and which ones are flat.
Right.
You know, right. And they tell you if you see flood waters in front of you, don't go through it. Turn around.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and that's standard. And I don't know why people think that they can make it. I think we have these grandiose ideas of, you know, we've got this superhuman survivability, I guess. I don't know. And people just think they can make it. And, you know, and it's like, no, you can't all the time. And we have to use some wisdom when we're in these emergency situations. And so one of the things that we have learned here, and when we did the CERT training, the fire department representatives who were teaching the course said that one of the reasons they have this is that if we have a major emergency, the fire department and EMTs are not coming out to your neighborhood.
Yes.
You're going to have to be prepared. That's what they told us. You're going to have to be prepared
mm-hmm.
to take care of whatever situation you find yourself in. Perfect example, Hurricane Harvey.
Mm.
There were 56,000 calls in 15 hours for 911.
Wow.
56,000 in 15 hours. There's no way that any city can respond to 56,000 911 calls in that amount of time.
Mm-hmm. Wow, yes.
And so people need to start thinking about personal sovereignty, independence, and taking care of yourself. Second of all, when the governor declared or the president declares that this is a state of emergency, EMTs are not coming unless they are directed by the police department or whoever's in charge. They're just not going to come because you call 911. They have to be directed to come by another entity.
Mm. Yes.
And I know you know it because that's standard operating procedure. And so with that understanding, neighborhoods need to, not only neighborhoods, but HOAs, you know, subdivisions, what else we have, civic clubs need to band together and develop some skill that when we are in those emergency situations, you know what to do. If somebody has a broken arm, if there's a fire, if there's a flood, if somebody gets bitten by a snake, if somebody gets cut, what are you going to do when an ambulance can't come?
Right.
Or it's flooding and you have to break out of the house, the upstairs window, and jump and you break a leg.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So those kinds of things, I think, are what CERT is all about, but not enough people are becoming trained in emergency response. Not
Absolutely.
Enough people are prepared. Another thing that happens, okay, you're watching, you know, out of the window during the storm. You see the water is coming up, And it gets to a point where, you know, you realize, we can't stay here. This is not stopping. Mm-hmm. So you realize you got to leave. Most people do not have any emergency items packed.
Yes, yes.
They don't have any documents. And emergency preparedness says you should have your documents in a plastic container. You should have minimally three days worth of provisions. You need to have one, two, or three changes of clothes.
Mm-hmm.
I would say 99% of the people do not do that.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have a storm. People have to leave in a hurry. Don't have anything.
Mm-hmm.
Let's say the house gets ruined. Everything in there is wet. If there's paper or whatever, you can't find anything. Or perhaps the force of the water went in your house and then went back and pulled stuff out. You can't find anything. You didn't take anything with you, can't find anything.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's really important for us to pay attention to emergency preparedness. If there are any lessons to learn from this experience,
right,
we need to take emergency preparedness seriously.
Mm-hmm.
We need to follow the guidelines that they give us, you know, about having a first aid kit, about all the things that they say. We need to do that. We need to know how to render aid, give mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. You know, we need to know how to splint. We need to know how to stop bleeding.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
We need to know how to do triage.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
Indeed.
So, and that's, you know, in your community, wherever you live, you need to have a group of people that you can count on to do that, to work together, you know?
Agreed, absolutely. Mm-hmm. And, Arnold, I have a copy of this book, and I'm not sure if you know Brother Eitan Edwards. He's a survival brother, and he has this, the organization is called International Preparedness Network, and I believe he's still out in New York, but he actually prepared, he predicted the World Trade Center bombing some years ago, but he talks, and I have this book, and I'm showing it to everybody, but several of the chapters, and I just want to, you know, read some of the chapter heads, you know, chapter one is facing facts and preparing for them, and in that, let me kind of just read this. Okay, the Millennium Assessment Report, drafted by the year 2000, by 1,360 of the world's top scientists, backed by the World Bank, United Nations, report that we have polluted, exhausted, or completely destroyed over 2/3 of the Earth's most critical resources, including the most important, our fresh water supply. We continue to act as though we had a spare planet to exploit once we've torn the life off of this one, but we don't. Besides doing everything we can to minimize future damage to the planet, we must all begin in a grounded and proactive way to prepare ourselves for the consequences of our global environmental crisis. And you said earlier, as part of our conversation, you paying attention to some of the things Dr. David Icke has talked about. So some of these threats, you know, that can create a level of destabilization within society, you know, are out here. Not just the hurricane, but there are many different fundamental dynamics that can arise that people need to be aware of wherever it is that they are living.
Yeah.
You know, so, and like you said, in terms of triage, because of course it can get a little, shall I say, heightened, you know, a situation with, you know, looking at what happened in Katrina at the Superdome. So what have you seen there, you know, in terms of the level of of responsiveness and the calm or the, you know, the response from FEMA to this?
The response has been good. And as I, you know, I've mentioned before, Houston is a large city, large metropolitan city. Mm-hmm. We have many resources here.
Right.
Many assets.
Mm-hmm.
And FEMA has an office here. So, I mean, so we're in, you know, in terms of getting FEMA services and getting FEMA out to, like, the George R. Brown to render services, we are in pretty good shape. The surrounding area, small city, they are not going to have a FEMA office. Dickinson, that was destroyed about 85%, they don't have a FEMA office. Orange, Beaumont, Port Arthur, Texas, they don't have FEMA offices. So, and these small places, Crosby and Warden, all of those places, their access to FEMA is going to be much more difficult, and especially if they get caught, cut off, where you can't access and you can't get case managers there and all of that. They can fill out the forms online, and there's only so much can be done online. Eventually, a FEMA representative is going to have to come out to where you are and assess, you know, if it's your home, assess the damage or whatever, and make a recommendation in terms of compensation. So for those out-of-line areas, it may take more time. But I thought FEMA was efficient. I mean, the situation was dire. There was nothing you could do. You know, you couldn't withhold service because it was just too dire to do that.
Mm-hmm.
I would give them, I'll give them kudos for their response here in Houston in comparison to perhaps how they were in New Orleans during Hurricane Katrina.
Mm-hmm. Right. What's interesting, and I was browsing through this book, and I mentioned this, and I'll mention it to the audience out here. It's called the shock doctrine, the rise of disaster capitalism, and this is what Naomi Klein, who has several books out, but when this book came out, it really elaborated on how different organizations, for instance, I'll just go off the top of my head, something I read earlier, how I believe in Hurricane Katrina, and I only got it from this source, but they more so used private ties, forces, you know, and contractors for different dynamics. And so that's something that individuals have to be concerned about when individuals may not necessarily be, I guess in her view and experience, were not necessarily the most prepared and most qualified entity to conduct these different operations.
Right. I think we all need to be concerned about privatization, period.
Mm.
Because privatization is really parochialism. What it ends up doing is ends up directing where monies go and who gets to access to funds and money. When you make it private, that means that only certain people, certain companies have access to the capital or the opportunities for the capital.
Mm-hmm.
When you say, well, you know, we are hiring so-and-so-and-so to do the building for us, because, you know, that's who we contract with. When you eliminate a whole lot of people, when you tighten the reins, and it's not only happening in, let's say, in utilities and public services, like, let's say, schools contract privately, whereas make schools pick up their own trash. Now they have a company they contract for to pick up the trash. Where schools used to have their own cafeterias, they now contract someone else to come in and cook the food. And the people who used to work in the cafeteria, who used to usually are black and brown people and would rise through the ranks to, you know, to the upper level management positions, well, the private company has the upper level management position and they get paid more. And then the cafeteria workers have nowhere to go but to always stay in the same place in mm-hmm. low-paying jobs. So we need to be concerned about privatization in any industry that restricts funding, and that there are some stipulations that provide. And most of the time, we don't like to think this way because, you know, black folks, we are in a constant state of disbelief about everything because we're so good, we're so good-hearted, we're so loving, and we're so kind, and we're so compassionate with people. We just can't imagine that people will make a plan to cut black folks out of the money. We just can't fathom that because that's not something we would do.
Mm. Wow.
But people would create a design that when you get ready to go to a company, and let's say you're John Smith Brown, upstanding black man, got all your degrees and your experience and all of that, and you apply to do a contract with XYZ company, well, because they got this whole apparatus set up, well, you're not going to get the contract because they've written up a whole bunch of other stuff over here that eliminates you. And we have to be careful in all of these industries and also schools and hospitals and a whole bunch of industries where they have this stuff tied up, where they are looping the money and it's only going to the good old bar network, and it's the money's getting tied up again like it used to be, but seriously tied up. So that if you don't walk the line of the system, you can't make money off the system, or you can't get access. And a lot of those spaces are being closed off. If you come out of them, if you quit a job, some of these spaces are going to be hard to get back into because the loops are closing on them.
Wow. Yeah. Yeah. That's a good point. And it's interesting that you mentioned about schools, because I read that in Hurricane Katrina, that was one of the first things that what came in was the charter school movement.
Privatization of schools.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know, and taking over schools. But, you know, Haki, there's so much going on so many levels that it bothers our mind. And we're suffering from cognitive dissonance. Because the things that are happening and challenging us, it is so much and so massive, we can't wrap our head around it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, any area that you can think of, there is some mess going on in that area. I don't care what industry, it could be education, entertainment, medical, law. You know, we can look at the nine areas that Dr. Neely Fuller talks about. There's some mess going on in those areas.
Mm-hmm.
And we can't wrap our minds around it because we don't think like that. We don't think about, you know, 20, 50 years planning some evil we're going to do to somebody.
You know?
We can't wrap our mind about where in 100 years we're going to sew this thing up where ain't nobody going to be able to get in it but us. You know, we don't think like that.
Wow.
And the difference between, I think, black folk and other folk is that we think about relationships. We think about, we value people. We value our feelings. We value the caring we have between us. We value that kind of thing. Other cultures are more object and materialistic, and that's what they value. They value the object of things.
Mm.
So they place value on possession and control and time and structure. We place value on joy and happiness and my relationship and smiles to you. So here we have these cultures that are juxtaposed to each other. Mm. And of course we have a conflict in values because we don't value things the same way. And maybe we're not clutching and grabbing onto something because it's just not our way, but someone else is clutching and grabbing it because we're like, oh, if you want that, you can have it. That's traditionally people of African descent's nature. So what happens is because we won't clutch and grab and objects don't mean as much to us. I mean, it's changing, of course, because of the culture that we live in. You know, folk want everything. They want to control everything. They want every possession, every inch of the earth. There are some people who do want every inch of the earth. And that's a challenge for us because we don't think that way.
Yes, yes, yes. I would like to add just a little something, and I'm going to ask you a question after I make this point. I have, for those that can see, I have in front of me the film, the gentrified film copies of that. But I want to read something from that, and then I'm going to go to this shock doctrine to add to what you were saying. And this is gentrified, ethnic cleansing, American style. It said, what if you could remove an entire race of people without firing a shot? Most people say gentrification is about the poor, but the explosive new documentary from Black Channel Films exposes how the government, private industry work together to target black people for removal in order to make whole cities you can't afford to live in. Now, let me read this part of In Shock Doctrine, and this is, you know, about the rebuilding process. And it said, something else was familiar. The contractors, you know, meaning the private-public partnership or whatever they called it, aversion to hire local people who might have seen the reconstruction of New Orleans not only as a job, but as part of a healing and re-empowering their communities. Washington could have easily have made it a condition of every Katrina contract that companies hire local people at decent wages to help them put their lives back together. Instead, the residents of the Gulf Coast, like the people of Iraq, because she talks about Iraq in this as well, were expected to watch as contractors created an economic boom based upon easy taxpayer money and relaxed regulations. Let me read this little last part. The results, predictably, was that all of the layers of subcontractors had taken their cut. I'm sorry. After the layers of subcontractors had taken their cut, there was next to nothing left for the people doing the work. And it goes on a little bit more after that, elaborate. But, you know, we just have to really, I feel, have a good understanding of what the next process is in terms of trying to getting people back to normal, if there's a such thing in this country, because there's all types. I tell people, and I posted some people, I wasn't being insensitive, but there are various levels of what I consider low intensity warfare that's going on, certainly within many urban environments. You know, I look at everything, you know, from a warfare tactic that, you know, certain things may not necessarily happen in more affluent areas, you know. But one question that came up, and you can elaborate on what I said, but I definitely want to ask you this. To your estimation, or has there been widespread views there that individuals, African Americans of Houston, were not being rescued at particular times? And I know that I saw one particular gentleman Facebooking live saying they not saving the black people. And, you know, I didn't want to, I mean, I just know, for instance, that there's the public, you know, the emergency responders, but then there are civilians that may be doing certain things. So, who's to say what people actually saw? And, you know, it could be...
Yeah, I, you know, I can't address that because I was not out there as an emergency responder.
Yes.
I would imagine that those people who were involved in the emergency response from the standpoint of official responders, first responders, they know whether or not they did or not. But then I also said, you know, earlier, they had 56,000 calls.
Right.
Now,
agreed.
You know, whether or not they decided which part of town they were going to go in versus another, I don't know the
agreed.
Answer to
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
You know, I don't know you know, if there was some kind of prior to, you know, prioritizing of who got rescued or which area got rescued.
Agreed.
Or was
right.
it based on the how critical the situation was. But luckily, there were people who were rescuing people where they were. You know, people took action rather than standing, you know, just being still waiting for someone. And that's what we have to do is be proactive. But, you know, this situation here has made me start thinking about maybe I need a boat. You know what I'm saying? You know, because if something happened, I need to help my own self, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So I really don't know. I have heard some, you know, some rumblings about that, about mm-hmm. how, whether or not they were rescuing black people, but I really don't know the answer to that. But what I can say, the coverage of the situation in black neighborhoods was not really covered right away. I mean, other areas were covered. There were places where, you know, the majority of black people live was not even on the news.
Mm.
You know, so that much I can say, but whether or not there was some unfair, you know, rescuing people, I don't really know mm-hmm. for sure. And so I wouldn't want to address that.
Yeah, I understand. And, you know, that could be quite subjective. I mean, only those that really are on the ground and in different areas can say what was there a widespread effort, because like you said, people, you know, in a incident command system, you're looking at different things. You're looking at the most damage and what you truly can access safely. You know, you want your, you know, we're taught to, you know, you can't become a hazard. That's why, you know, yourself when you're trying to save people. And that's one thing, you know, I was, you know, people just rushing off talking about they're going down to Texas. You know, I'm like, look, I mean, there's a structure in place that, you know, you just can't run up in somewhere with no training, no assessment, no intel on the ground, and no real gear. Yeah.
Right, and the way those situations are, you know, they emergency management, FEMA has a protocol.
Right.
And anybody who's working with FEMA or under FEMA in an emergency situation has to follow that protocol. FEMA provides online training that's free so that people can understand what the chain of command is, what are the areas that people focus it on, and what area perhaps maybe you could be assigned to. That option is available, but you cannot come right in the midst of an emergency. If that's something you want to do, then now is the time to prepare between emergencies. And then if you want to come to help with the Red Cross, you have to go through the training with the Red Cross in order to be a Red Cross volunteer. That training is online and free as well.
Exactly.
Now, like for Houston, for example, they had made the decision that, you know, everybody's going to go through the Red Cross for the typical things that the Red Cross does, and the Red Cross will filter out, you know, when the people first come in, they come into the Red Cross, because that's your crisis and your emergency group, and then they fan out to the other areas. Now, here in Houston, the Yoon Center, which is a center for Carl Yoon, was a psychiatrist. And so there is a Jung Center that practices his philosophy about psychology, psychiatry, and he was a contemporary of Freud. So they were designated as the group that the mental health volunteers went through. And they did provide some guidelines about what to do and so forth. So if somebody wants to volunteer, not only in a situation like this, but in any emergency situation, and you know you want to be a first responder, or a second responder, then you start training now so that when the time comes, you're ready to go.
Mm.
Or you can affiliate with, for example, there's an organization that's based in San Antonio who is a major contractor for FEMA, and they handle a lot of second responder types of issues.
Mm-hmm.
You know, getting people the resources they need, directing them, or being a disaster relief case manager, which, you know, I trained to do that myself.
Mm-hmm.
So if people want to do that, you do that before there's an emergency, and you decide you know, they have months where you're on a call if something should happen, and you're on call. You can be on call for a month, that didn't happen, and you can decide if you want to be on call the next month or not, so forth, because it's more flexible. But this organization in San Antonio distributes people all over the country and also internationally when there's a disaster that is impacting Americans or that FEMA is involved with.
Mm-hmm.
So that option is available for folks. Just know that when you go to these emergency situations, there's a chain of command.
Mm-hmm.
It's a military setting, really.
Right.
It's very structured, very authoritative, mm-hmm. and all of that, where you know where you're supposed to be and who you're supposed to be and following directions and do what they say. It's like that.
Right.
And so it's not no Harry Carey that you're just going to come in, I'm just going to volunteer. You come in, you got to do what you're structured to do.
Right, right.
You know? And I know you know that because you know of your background.
Right, right. And that's you know, we have to understand that there are going to be different reasons why things are done on
right.
a level. And this is why we need, you know, why I tried to bring a broad, unique perspective to this conversation. And I just
right.
want to mention, I was reading, Maryland has a plan where individuals can look at the different jurisdictions, the 24 counties, and you can see like what is a particular threat, you know, hurricanes, tornadoes
uh-huh.
in your particular area, because you
right.
know, I mean, and that's where sometimes you can just know your risk just based upon certain particular demographics. I mean, you know, not everybody uh-huh. lives in an immediate flood area. I mean, of course,
right.
you can have some rivers, but overwhelmingly, for instance, you know, it may not be such a big challenge, you know, even with, you know, 50 inches of water.
Right, right.
That's what...
And so, it's not automatic. But, you know, up where you live, I mean, you know, snowstorms are an issue.
Yeah, absolutely.
Know?
Absolutely. Agree. Yeah.
You know, y'all had a few, you know, kind of critical situations.
Oh, I know, right. Yeah, agree. And that's what the, you know, the plans, and I've been through several different drills and worked during them. So,
mm-hmm.
you know, I've seen, you know, firsthand how incapacitating, for instance, a whole city could be,
right.
you know, just for,
right.
from just... Just from
exactly, and you know the
right.
storm that's brewing out there in the Atlantic right now, Irma.
Right.
You know, there's some predictions. Seem like some of the predictions that they're leaning to more of a probability going up the East Coast.
I saw something about that. Right. Yes.
Right. You know,
yes.
they saying it could come our way, but most of the predictions saying you know it's going up the East Coast. So you know, the people on the East Coast might have an opportunity. They might want to. You might have about 5 or 6 more days before we really know. You might want to do some training and get ready just in case.
Yeah, yes, this is the season for that. And again, brothers and sisters, I would say, you know, definitely prepare this now. I got copies of this, and this is the CERT mm-hmm. team handbook that for those that are trained, you know, although
mm-hmm.
I've worked in emergency services, I still went through the training.
I hear you. You don't want to take anything
member.
From granted.
Right.
But you know, I want to talk a little bit about weather and weather manipulation and control. So a lot of people are saying in the aftermath of the storm that they felt like the storm was man-made here, or the storm was, or the flooding was man-made. And they said the same thing about Katrina. And Rita.
Yes.
And I'll tell you, years ago, because I'm an avid reader, and I also have read a lot of Dr. Nick Begich books and research, and he's done a lot of research about harp, you know, supposedly a weather manipulating constellation. And then I, in the course of my reading across genres, I read once, it was online, and I don't even know if you can access it anymore. One thing I read, it was this company who had been contracted to create precipitation over maritime. And maritime, of course, what is maritime? Maritime is over the sea, right? So the question would become, why do you need to create maritime, I mean, create precipitation over maritime? And, you know, and they had been working on this for years. I forgot how long it said. I don't know if they've been working on the 50s, 60s, whatever. But this was a long, ongoing project creating precipitation. And what that said to me, and I asked the question, if you created precipitation over maritime, what would be the conditions that would be necessary to create precipitation over maritime? And what does that mean? That you're creating precipitation, you're creating rain, you're creating hurricanes. What are you creating, and what conditions are you manipulating on in order to do that? So I thought about that when I read that years ago. Something else I read some years ago, that they have these machines, these technology devices that emit certain frequencies. And, you know, almost everything has its own frequency signature. Rain has a frequency signature, hail, snow, a lot of things, diseases, a lot of things have frequency signatures. So I was reading this article, and several people had put in bills and co-signing bills in Congress to try to regulate who have these frequency minting devices. Our own senator at the time, Kay Bailey Hutchinson, was one of those that had submitted a bill so that it could be controlled. Most countries, you know, like the United States, Russia, and all of that, countries have these weather manipulating, based on the reading, have these weather manipulating devices and these frequency emitting devices, as well as people who own property. They were talking in the article about people who have car dealerships. You know, if it's going to hail, you know, emitting frequencies to keep it from hailing and trying to change the dynamics of weather. So what that is saying is that you may have wealthy individuals with these frequency emitting devices. You may have countries with these devices. Like, who's regulating who has these devices and is doing what? If people are manipulating the weather where they are because of economic reasons, they don't want hail balls to fall on their BMW parking lot. And then you have somebody is creating the desert over in Ethiopia, somebody is creating rain. You know, it's like, who's doing all this stuff, and how is that stuff regulated? So several people were trying to get that stuff regulated. I haven't heard anything more about it. So when we talk about weather manipulation and weather control and all of that, Nick Begich has several books in which he talks about this, and he talks about HAARP, and he has postulated that this constellation called HAARP out there near Alaska, whatever, is very much involved in manipulating and controlling weather. And he talks also about, you know, when you got wind in the upper atmosphere and bending wind, and it's a whole lot of, a technical way of looking at how do you create a hurricane, how do you capture wind, what do you use devices to bend the wind flow that's in the upper atmosphere to cause it to circle and make a hurricane or whatever. So, you know, so when people talk about weather being created, I can't say that I know anything about that but I have read that there is technology out there that it could possibly be true.
We appreciate that, and what you're talking about is people can look it up. Angels don't play these harp, and angels still don't play these harp. You know, several books about that, and Jerry Smith has a popular book as well So, mm-hmm. so yeah, but we got to go, sister.
Okay.
But yeah, and definitely, and you were on the Carl Nelson show, so I appreciate you taking the time out. You just had a busy day, but let's give out some contact information. You do another show as well,
Right, and so, you know, we didn't really get a chance to really talk about, you know, because we were all over the place, but I hope it was interesting. Folks can contact me. I'm on Facebook, Anelle Williams, A-N-E-L-L-E. I'm also on Twitter, Anelle Williams 1, and on Instagram, Anelle Williams Speaks. My email is lightinfocusradio@gmail.com, and I'm on Sunday nights, KPFT Houston, www.kpft.org if you're listening across the country.
All right. Appreciate it, Sister Nell, and you
okay.
Be safe there and keep up the good work. All right?
We shall be in touch. Thank you so much for having me, Haki.
Thanks, everybody.
Okay, bye-bye.
All right. All right, everybody. Thank you all for tuning in, listening. Man, it's been good. Been a must-hear show. And we're going to have Toni Harris on with us next week. She's also from Houston. So we're just going to, you know, people that I've been wanting to get on for a minute, but... So from Houston, so just wanted to deal with that. So I want to thank everybody for tuning in. Good show. So holler at the Success Scholar. Get yourself prepared. That's now. Get gentrified, ethnic cleansing, American style. Holler at the Success Scholar. I'm out. Peace.